Legal. Olá a todos que entraram. Apenas dizendo que vamos começar em alguns minutos, só esperando uma pequena tolerância para começarmos aqui os nossos trabalhos, tá bom? Coisa de 2 ou 3 minutinhos. Muito obrigado. Olá a todos e todas, sejam muito bem-vindas e muito bem-vindos. Este é o 4º Congresso Internacional de Direitos Fundamentais e Processo Penal na Era Digital, organizado pelo Internet Lab com o apoio da Faculdade de Direito da Universidade de São Paulo. Meu nome é Francisco Brito Cruz, eu sou o diretor do Internet Lab e... oficialmente aqui, abro os trabalhos do nosso congresso. Bom, com o avanço da tecnologia digital hoje disponível, a vultuosa quantidade de informação coletada, compartilhada e processada atualmente, impactam as dinâmicas criminais e a forma como as agências penais operam em resposta. São mais de 4 bilhões de usuários de internet no mundo. O acesso e a capacidade de processamento de computadores e smartphones cresce a cada dia. Os órgãos de investigação incorporam novas técnicas, às vezes controversas, né, em termos da sua precisão e da sua segurança, amparadas em tecnologia e ciência de dados nas suas atividades de prevenção e repressão. Nesse contexto, emergem uma série de novas questões sobre a proteção da intimidade, do sigilo, sobre os novos meios de obtenção de prova, de investigação, sua admissibilidade e o valor para fins de instrução processual. Esse congresso, agora na sua quarta edição, busca avançar no debate a respeito das garantias do devido processo penal e da tutela de direitos fundamentais diante desse quadro. Internet Lab, que é um centro independente de pesquisa em direito e tecnologia, sediado em São Paulo, com apoio institucional da Faculdade de Direito da USP, com muito orgulho, começa mais uma dessas nossas, uma das edições do nosso querido congresso. Estou aqui com a professora Marta Saad, professora de Direito Processual Penal da Faculdade de Direito da USP, que promove conosco o congresso desde 2017. Queria saudar a professora, como vai?
Obrigada, Francisco. Tudo tranquilo.
Bom, em nome do nosso planejamento, a gente vai comentar um pouco sobre a programação do congresso após a exposição da nossa keynote. Então, vou passar a palavra para a professora Marta também, para a gente comentar um pouco das mesas e tal, especialmente porque a nossa palestrante de hoje, a nossa keynote speaker, a professora Sarah Laxton, ela tem até às 7 horas conosco, às 7 horas da noite, e a gente vai abreviar essa introdução, essa apresentação, justamente para poder aproveitar o tempo dela conosco. Antes de passar a palavra para a professora Sara, eu vou fazer alguns avisos. São dois principais. Peço só que a professora Marta, se puder mutar, professora. Boa, obrigado. Os dois avisos são os seguintes aos nossos participantes. Em primeiro lugar, essa mesa conta com tradução simultânea em dois canais. Então, tem tradução do inglês para o português e do português para o inglês. Aqui na ferramenta do Zoom, embaixo, né, você tem uma barra que possui uma opção, que é um globo, né? Nessa opção, você consegue mudar qual é o canal que você prefere ouvir, né? O idioma que você prefere ouvir. Caso você opte pela tradução simultânea, você terá a opção de ouvir também o áudio original em um volume mais baixo ou mutá-lo, né? Passo aqui para os nossos intérpretes se tem algum comentário a respeito do funcionamento da ferramenta, só para esclarecer. Tem algum comentário? Obrigado. Espero que esteja funcionando para todo mundo. E, além disso, temos outro aviso, que é: essa sessão, assim como todas as sessões do Congresso, vai ter uma parte para debates. Como são muitos participantes, a gente está aqui nessa versão virtual, esse ano, o que a gente pede é que as perguntas sejam feitas a partir da janela de perguntas e respostas do próprio Zoom, e não no chat do Zoom. Essa janela de perguntas e respostas também está na barra embaixo do Zoom, é sinalizada com a sigla QIA, Questions and Answers. Então, você, para fazer uma pergunta qualquer, você abre esta janela e ali pode enviar as perguntas a partir dessa ferramenta. Eu, na qualidade de mediador, vou estar acompanhando e vou dirigir as perguntas em bloco para a professora Sara ao final da exposição dela. Enfim, sem mais delongas, partimos para a nossa primeira apresentação do Congresso. Professora Sara Laxton, que é da School of Criminal Justice da Universidade de Rutgers, de Newark. Ela é professora assistente nessa instituição, socióloga com pesquisa em direito penal, privacidade, vigilância e tecnologia. O seu livro Digital Punishment foi publicado pela Oxford University Press em junho desse ano e a gente fica muito feliz de tê-la conosco. Professora Sara, agora a palavra é sua.
Thank you so much. Thank you for this really generous invitation from Internet Lab. I am honored to be here and to share my work with you and begin to learn about really what's becoming a global phenomenon of using data in the justice system in new ways, and often by international players who are profiting from this and helping to expand the use of such technologies. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. I think we should be good. So I'm here today to tell you about research I've done in the United States on this phenomenon that I've been calling digital punishment. But this really fits into this broader question of the Congress of what does procedure mean in the digital age? What does the presumption of innocence or due process mean? Or what are fundamental rights when there's such opportunity for information about people to be used across platforms and in a variety of ways. Digital punishment, in the way I write about it, is the consequence of data-driven legal operations. So the push to use more data to organize criminal legal systems. And then in the US, combining this with very permissive public records laws. And the result, the punishment part, is this permanent stigmatization and discrimination of the millions of people who are simply accused of crimes each year in the US. And an additional problem is that as each different branch of the legal system, the police, the courts, the jails, the prisons, expand their data collection and data dissemination practices, many errors and incorrect data problems start to arise. So these outdated and incorrect records have become not only a problem within the justice system, but a problem outside of the justice system as they've become a valuable data commodity in the private sector. And what this ultimately does is incentivize companies to create surveillance products to capture personal information that these same companies can aggregate and sell to criminal record consumers. So to illustrate this, I'm gonna share a couple anecdotes from my book, and these are from interviews with residents of New Jersey where I did some of my research. And first there's Cindy, who was arrested in 2010 after attempting to fill a fake prescription, a forged prescription at a pharmacy. She was battling some addictions at that time. The pharmacist refused the prescription and she left the pharmacy, got into her vehicle and accidentally got in a very minor car accident with the police officer that was being called to the scene. Terrible situation. However, she was charged and arrested with forgery, but then she was also arrested for attempted murder and aggravated assault of a police officer. Once she went through her trial, of course, all of the other charges were dropped. She served 1 year in prison for the forgery conviction. Everything else was dismissed. But a Google search of her name 10 years later reveals her photo with the words attempted murder of police underneath her. And being in the US, she cannot get her search results removed or altered. Then there's Carl, a young man who was convicted of a gun charge in 2005 for which he completed 2 years of probation. He, as of 2015, was legally eligible to have his criminal record expunged or sealed from public view. He needs to do this to keep his job that he has. He works as a security guard in a local high school. So his employer said, you must get this record expunged to keep your job. There is a clerical error in one of his court records, though. Some numbers are mixed around. And the courts could not, for 5 years, figure out how to remedy this error to allow him to pursue this expungement, even though he drove from courthouse to courthouse across the state of New Jersey to try to find the file. And finally, there's Alan. He's a father in New Jersey who was arrested at 5 o'clock in the morning at his home for failing to appear to court. So when he didn't come to court, they issued a warrant for his arrest. The police came and arrested him. He was held in jail over the entire weekend. He went and saw the judge on Monday morning, and she quickly realized that the summons for him to come to court had been sent to his old address. So he never knew about the court date in the first place. He was released from jail and he had his arrest record legally expunged. However, his mugshot, of course, shows up on Google search results for his name. And because of this, he has been withdrawing job applications due to these Google search results. In the fear that this arrest, though it had been expunged, would show up in a consumer background check. So one important distinction I want to make is that digital punishment doesn't just include what we traditionally think of as a criminal record, which would be a conviction record. Instead, I argue in the book that any and all points of contact with the justice system in general create new digital forms of criminal records, including arrests that never lead to conviction. And I think this really gets to the heart of your Congress of thinking about what our rights are before a conviction. So I'll talk today about the qualities of digital punishment that I think are relevant to the data-driven advances that you're seeing here in Brazil. I'll explain more about the social and legal context that allowed for this to rise in the United States. And then I'll close with several discussion points about policy or research interventions. So after, you know, doing years of fieldwork in multiple states across the US, I came up with sort of four central qualities of digital punishment. The first is that it's disordered. So as I said, this kind of stigmatization can extend from a police stop all the way to after a conviction. There are public records, meaning like the actual court records, and there's private versions of these records held by data brokers or personal data companies. Because these are criminal records, you know, court cases change, right? So as your case proceeds through court, the old record automatically becomes stale. And so when data companies take cross-sectional records, they're automatically getting stale data. However, you know, that data persists in the private market and people have very little ability to manage all these different types of records. These records are commodified into a big data product. They're mined, scraped, they're merged with other records, and they're sold on the private market. And I'll tell you a lot more about what that looks like in the US. Of course, these records are surveilling. So one way to think about digital punishment or the digital marking of people is what Margaret Hu, a legal scholar, calls big data blacklisting, meaning you don't even need the type of reasonable suspicion required in the United States to sort of arrest somebody or surveil somebody. Now it can be a very low level of suspicion to sweep people into databases. This leads to labeling, right? Labeling people as criminals or as suspicious or risky well before they've ever even exhibited such behavior or been convicted legally of such behavior. And then when all of these data points are created, they become the self-reinforcing loop of algorithmic injustice. So whereas one wrongful arrest can go on your record and then justify the next wrongful arrest simply by relying on the fact that there is already arrest data about you. So it becomes a very self-reinforcing digital prison in that way. And finally, the disparities that we see in the American criminal justice system, the racism that we see in the American criminal justice system is extended, of course, into the digital version of the legal system. And not only do I mean that people who are more likely to be targeted by police, perhaps, or by overzealous prosecutors are going to be poor people, they're often people of color, they're people who are suffering addiction or mental health problems. So not only are they more likely to have to cope with stigmatization of digital punishment, but these are the same people that are often less likely to have the tools to remedy or to fight back. So we might think of this as having privacy capital and the ways that social stratification exacerbates privacy capital, where people with less resources are not able to sort of address or remedy their digital reputations. So where do these records come from in the US? So I'll start with the origins of these records and then I'll show you what they actually look like on the internet as they exist in the digital world. So there's really two main types of records that are produced in the pre-conviction stage. So first is the arrest record. A person is arrested by police. Their name is entered into a jail roster that many police departments post on their website now and they update it so that family members or the public, or perhaps a person's attorney can see what their custody status is. However, there's a bunch of bots that will come and crawl these jail rosters and scrape up all of this data that's being put online for free. It gets reposted to public interest websites, to social media, or to public records aggregators, and then these are often indexed into Google search results. Records also come from the criminal charging stage. So if you're charged in court, this digital court docket becomes part of a large bulk data set. These data sets are bought and sold on the private market. They're merged with other types of consumer data and public record data, and then they're resold as a new package of personal data to the background checking industry. So what we see in the criminal justice agency side is these police departments and these courts that are trying to modernize their data practices, but with very limited resources to do so. So they're trying really hard to maintain institutional control over their practices, over their data, but they're not developing their own software. They're relying on private companies and third parties to do this for them. At the same time, they're trying to be responsive to Freedom of Information Act requests or to public notification, but they're increasingly losing control over the data itself. This gets even trickier when you have an effort to synthesize data across agencies. So the police are trying to work with the courts, who are trying to work with probation, and you get a very messy data environment. The result is we've seen these efforts to modernize internal operations of criminal justice, of management investigations, but in doing so, all of these agencies have actually started to produce a valuable data commodity. And of course, like I said, this often means that this is archived, outdated, and misleading data that is increasingly available to the public. This is an analysis that we did. The N here is the number of US states that just will post different types of records onto their websites, typically at no cost, except for those two asterisks there. There are there is a paywall for those records. But if you think about the scope of the justice system in America, how many people are arrested each year, and are booked each year, the numbers are quite staggering. So each year, about 10 million arrest records are just put onto the internet by the police at no cost, 19 million court records. Then of course you multiply that over a 5-year span and you can see how large this problem becomes very quickly. What is the legal background here? So the First Amendment of the US Constitution protects the republication of information that's been obtained from publicly accessible sources. So if the government makes something public, then it is perfectly legal for other people to repost it, to make money off of it, to use it in whichever way they want. And even if, you know, a newspaper were to publish my mugshot and I was never convicted of a crime, I can't sue that newspaper because they have truthfully posted the public information about my arrest. This also includes arrests that are sealed or expunged. So in this case, a person's mugshot was on a website, their booking photo was on a website, their record was sealed after the charges were dismissed, but the court argued that unfortunately, even though the legal reality is you could walk into a courtroom and say to a judge, I've never been arrested because your record has been sealed, the newspaper is legally allowed to still publish that because it is a historical event. So the historical accuracy of the arrest, the court sees as distinct from the legal version of the record. The regulation that we do have in the US really only covers consumer reporting agencies. These are background check companies that do a type of background check that employers can use to deny an applicant, and there are sort of privacy and accuracy standards reserved for that. However, the vast majority of websites do not fall under this category of a consumer reporting agency. So what does this look like? So we've got dozens of websites that are, you know, considered public records aggregators. They call themselves People Search Services. They claim, you know, we are not a Fair Credit Reporting Act compliant organization. This is just for curiosity and fun. So you can search for criminal records there. You can see they really like to emphasize how much data they have, which really contributes to the sort of fear that Americans have that they're always going to be victimized, that crime is always around the corner, though crime has really been going down the past couple decades, and really legitimizes the reason these websites exist. There's all sorts of other websites that do this. The websites are also adding in a reputation profile, so they'll look for social media or other sorts of evidence of that person on the internet and merge it with their criminal records. we have an unfortunate mugshot extortion industry in the United States, that there's some laws trying to address it, but it continues on where your mugshot will be posted and then the website will charge you thousands of dollars to have your mugshot removed just to have it show up on another website. They've really turned this into clickbait. They have advertisements like this about trying to get people to laugh at mugshots or to find them funny. And then a lot of these same websites that post the mugshots are now offering mugshot erasure or removal services as a separate service to try to get around this new legislation meant to stop this. So a large variety of these kind of informal websites that of course populate people's Google search results rather quickly. And then, you know, the companies that try to sort of do the more official version of this that will supply employers or landlords with background checks also use the same rhetoric of look how many records we have. They kind of are taking this idea that criminal records are so hard to find in the US because there's 50 states and thousands of counties and they each keep their own data sets, that these companies, these private companies, can come in and aggregate all that data so that it's a lot more user-friendly. And this is the kind of advertising you might see on these websites. So I'll direct your attention to the middle of the screen where it says, learning the truth about the history of your family and friends can be shocking, so please be cautious when using this tool. And this is a window you have to click through when you're using one of these criminal record people search websites. And you know, it's just a very, it's sort of silly, but it really gets to this point that, you know, we always want to learn more about people. And there's so many triggers on the internet to get us to keep clicking, to keep clicking. And so it's that same psychology that's now been applied to the criminal justice system. And that really has created a consumer class where people fully expect that they can look up this information for informational purposes, but also for shaming and for stereotyping and for creating discrimination. The interesting thing about this website, the same company that posted this warning and posts people's mugshots and creates this sense that America is a very dangerous place and it's really your duty to make sure you're searching for everybody on the internet. The company that produced that, this is the company's website. So their own brand is very distinct, right? Their own brand is that they are into yoga and surfing, and they are like the best technology company, very much embracing the Silicon Valley value system and trying to appear as sort of this organized, glossy culture. The reality is though, the product that they're selling is a very dehumanizing legal system that targets people, that hurts people, that is confusing and very harmful. And yet that's the commodity that they're selling, though they themselves see their company as being sort of the epitome of innovation. So we think about the commodification angle a bit more academically, and we sort of think about what a commodity means in a Marxist sense of something possessing a double form. So its natural form and then its value. And a sociologist, Rushkoff, has called commodification then the assignment of a value to a social good. And you know, we hear a lot about data commodification in sort of the consumer data sector, and often that's the collection and aggregation of personal data that we are often just sharing with apps, we are opting into sharing, when that data is used for economic ends. So I would argue that criminal record commodification is the use of public data, right? So we have transparency laws on the book so that the people can watchdog government. And that's why we have access to these criminal record information in the first place. But because it's been digitized and spread so quickly across the data brokering sector, you're really seeing the use of public data used for commercial purposes. And what this does is it's importing this tech logic to criminal punishment itself, that these companies are good at being objective, data-driven, transparent, and efficient in ways that government is not. So it's really expanding the pool of actors who are now inflicting criminal punishment. It's no longer the courts, it's also these third parties. So what happens to the people who are impacted by this? So in my study, I interviewed hundreds of people whose records appear on the internet, and it was remarkable how many people told me that they knew it was online, but they just didn't want to look at it. And it was really a sense of learned helplessness or kind of alienation. I know it's out there, but I've never really looked it up online. If it's out there, it's out there. I'm not interested. These are all different quotes from interviews. The last quote I think is really insightful. Albert said to me, I deliberately avoid it. It's a horror story I don't want to relive. And what good is my reaction to a website? What does that accomplish? And so earlier when I talked about sort of the disparities in digital punishment, you can see right here how people who are already under intense government surveillance, not only perhaps because of the justice system, but also because they maybe collect government benefits or they use government subsidized healthcare. They're already under extensive regimes of surveillance. They don't have the need to go seek this out on the internet. They know it maybe is out there, but they don't want to deal with it. Now the problem is if any of these people I talk to are going to apply for a job or an apartment, it's very likely that that decision maker will find their record online and that these people won't know exactly what that record says because they've never looked it up before. So really, when we think about the harms of this, it's sort of a difficult harm to measure because people in my study told me over and over about disengagement with schools, with churches, with their community, with public life, a disincentive to seek a better job or a better apartment. Honestly, think about living your life so that people never search for you on the internet, because the internet is not a safe space if you have a trail of mugshots or arrest records, regardless of whether or not you should have been arrested or those charges ever resulted in a conviction. And there's this brand new phenomenon in our COVID world. I have a screenshot at the bottom from YouTube here where court proceedings, which are open, right? Anyone in the US can walk into most courtrooms and watch the court proceedings take place, have now gone into Zoom and YouTube streaming court. So there's thousands of courtrooms that are live streaming all day long. And the logic behind live streaming court is the same as the logic of the early 90s when the court records began to get digitized and put on the internet. The idea was if they're technically a public record, anyone should be able to access them on whatever platform is available. Now, for hundreds of years, that meant you had to walk into a court or walk into the area of the court where they keep the files and retrieve something. And then the digital context meant you just had to go to a website to get it. Well, now we sort of have this next level of this live stream. I watched court last week. I saw two parents in fighting over custody of their child. They talked about the father's suicide attempt and alcoholism. They showed photographs of the interior of the couple's home, the bedrooms of their children, and it was all on Zoom and it was all on YouTube. I would argue that if we continue to broadcast court in this way, there could be a negative impact on democratic and legal participation, meaning witnesses or victims are going to be terrified to tell the truth if they know that their face and their name are being broadcast across the internet. So while the idea is a laudable goal of transparency, it turns out we're not getting transparency over the criminal legal system. We don't even know how many people are killed by the police every year in the United States. However, I could tell you the personal details of many, many people who are arrested by those police, their photographs, their addresses, all sorts of information that can be used against the people at the expense of learning more about how government is actually operating. So what are the implications? The first is that reverse sunshine effect. So if we have laws that are on the books to expand transparency over police, over prosecutors, those laws have now been leveraged for peer-to-peer surveillance. And so I urge you to, when you're thinking about sort of the implications of data in the legal system, it's not just the data that the police are collecting to use for police activities. It's also that the government is tricking us into observing each other, into surveilling each other, or to bring employers or people who are allowing cameras or the Amazon Ring doorbells, right? We're engaging in the project of surveillance without even realizing it. at the expense of actually getting good aggregate bulk data about the legal system itself. There's the garbage in, garbage out problem, a famous quote that's used often in the courts, right? So if you put bad data into an algorithm, the results are going to be bad. We criticize algorithms for being racist, for expanding inequality, when the algorithms are simply replicating the behavior of the legal system itself, which is in and of itself often targeting people based on the way that they look or the way or the area where they live. So not only do we have sort of this risk assessment problem, this algorithmic problem, but then for the individual person, they don't even know what their data is. So we really need, especially in the United States, to figure out a way to start treating a criminal record the way we treat credit reports, medical reports, educational reports, different types of administrative records that we know change our life chances and the way that we're treated. We should have access to our own data. These are very sticky labels, and by that I mean this is a type of stigmatization that can really endure across a person's life. It does not end with the jail sentence. It does not end with the acquittal or the conviction. And this really reinforces these stereotypes of crime is everywhere. People that are Black, people that are brown might be criminals because we are inundated by these images over and over in these mugshot galleries in the United States. So again, the policing behavior is translated into this digital canon, which just sort of legitimizes the entire operation. And then there's just public shaming. There's just the social and psychological difficulties that people have to cope with after they've been labeled, because now they have a sense they can never overcome that label. That will always be their defining characteristic. I think there's big concerns about covert discrimination. By that, I mean, we have some regulatory systems in place for background checks. We have parameters that employers have to use. They're going to deny somebody a job because of their criminal record. However, if I'm an employer and I have hundreds of applications, we have a recession now, right? There's going to be a lot of people applying for jobs. Do I want to pay $65 per background check for applicants? Probably not. So I could do an unregulated search and just search for people on Google and then take those names out of the pile and just say they weren't the right fit. They didn't have the right qualifications. And so it's the more public we make this criminal record data in the United States, regulation doesn't matter anymore because people won't have to abide by those rules. There's also a large push to increase expungement and criminal record sealing in the US. And while that's a very good and very important policy, especially for people who need occupational licensing. So if you work in healthcare, for instance, if you want to be a nurse, you know, having your record sealed can help you get that job. But the availability of these records on the internet and then these different versions of them that exist in these private spaces make those policies not very effective. And finally, there is this disparate impact. The likelihood of being swept into the system is already structured. And so, of course, the ability to remedy this digital version of the record is also structured by social class, comfort with technology, access to resources. So where do we go from here now that I've laid out the problem? So, you know, for my study, I think there were some narrow policy solutions that I came to. The first would be to reclassify criminal record data as a form of consumer data. There's ways to reclassify pre-conviction data in the US to be treated like post-conviction data, which ironically is has a lot more privacy protections. There's also ways to just sort of limit the ability to get bulk data. So we could go back to the original version of transparency law, which meant I want this file for this purpose, rather than just wholesale downloading every single person who's been processed through a police department. And for your work, as it overlaps with mine, I think it's more important than ever to really scrutinize the public-private partnerships and to think about the causality and the way that the arrows go. Meaning, do police even want a technology sometimes, or is a software company knocking on their door, right? And we've seen photos from these large technology conferences and these and these sort of way that vendors and salespeople bring their technologies into the public sphere. So really it's the time to scrutinize this relationship between public and private. I think we need to think about transparency differently. So transparency for the data subject versus the transparency for the institution. So think very critically about what that reverse sunshine effect might look like. And that means unboxing the algorithm. So even though these companies hide behind sort of a proprietary or a private sector defense against their work where they don't want to be transparent, it's more important than ever to understand what data is being collected and where it's going. And then I think there's also a private sector role. So in the US, we're pushing really hard for Google to just change their company policy on letting people request that their mugshots are removed from the internet. I don't see the right to be forgotten or the GDPR being imported anytime soon, unfortunately, in the US. So maybe we can start to put pressure on these companies to think about the ways that they are promoting and legitimizing the criminal justice system based on the role that they play in spreading this information. I'm gonna stop there and open it up for a discussion, but thank you so much for your attention and for joining in this conversation. And I look forward to hearing what you think.
Muito obrigado, Sara. Bom, só reforçando a todos os nossos participantes, que se precisarem de tradução, utilizarem a tecla abaixo. E a gente teve algumas perguntas enviadas pela ferramenta de perguntas e respostas, né? QIA. Mas antes disso, vou perguntar para se a professora Marta tem alguma pergunta. Eu tenho e vou fazê-la, mas vou passar primeiro para a professora se ela tem algum comentário a fazer.
Obrigada, Sara, pelas observações. Eu acho que isso mostra o quanto é difícil, de alguma maneira, ser esquecido, né, nos sistemas de internet, a publicidade toda que isso causa. O direito ao esquecimento é alguma coisa realmente difícil. Eu queria entender um pouco sobre o estágio do debate disso nos Estados Unidos, para saber exatamente se colocar contra essa publicidade excessiva pode ser taxado como uma liberdade, um cerceamento da liberdade ou de informação. Como que isso é visto? Porque aqui existe um debate muito grande entre acesso à informação e, de alguma maneira, privar as pessoas desse acesso. Então, eu queria ouvi-la um pouquinho sobre isso, sobre a questão como isso vem posto atualmente nos Estados Unidos.
Aproveitando a pergunta da professora Marta, eu queria fazer uma pergunta na sequência, aí a gente passa a palavra e faz em blocos de perguntas. Eu queria ouvir a professora Sara a respeito de um caso que ficou bem notório no debate estadunidense, a respeito de uma empresa chamada Clearview AI, que fazia raspagem, né, basicamente de imagens de pessoas em redes sociais e desenvolveu, a partir disso, treinou um sistema de reconhecimento facial e decidiu vendê-lo para agências de aplicação da lei nos Estados Unidos. Claro, vou pedir para a professora retomar um pouco o caso, mas eu queria também entender como que ela entende esse episódio, ficou bastante notório e contextualiza a partir do que ele escreveu.
Yeah, these are excellent questions, and I'll try to put them together a bit. I think if you had invited me here 6 months ago, my answers would be very different, but the murder of George Floyd has changed the conversation very, very radically and very quickly in the US. And as did the Clearview AI, that was sort of a premonition of a change in public opinion about the extent of the legal system. So I'd say that, you know, the Clearview AI, it was one person scraped all this data, created an algorithm, a remarkably precise facial recognition software. And so when we think about, you know, I talked about criminal record consumers, The police are a large part of that consumer class. They also subscribe to these private databases that they too believe can do a better job of retrieving information than their own government databases. And so it really gets to this merging of public-private. When Clearview AI became known in the media and people got very upset, I think it was one of the first times that people really understood that the legal system was not in a vacuum, that they could access these private sector technologies without any regulation. And so there was certainly a push at many local levels for police departments to disclose if they were using the software, to show the contracts to the public, to not use the software. Some cities passed ordinances against facial recognition very quickly. So that was sort of in the background. The murder of George Floyd and the protests intersected with that as protesters started to get arrested, and there became a movement in the media to blur the faces of protesters after photographs were taken from the demonstrations. And so they did kind of overlap. I will say that, you know, in America, the supremacy of the technology company over regulation is a way of life. And to imagine, you know, having the ability to petition Google to respond to any requests in America the way that people can petition in the EU, it isn't in people's political reality. However, I think that this conversation we're having in the US about criminal justice is starting to expand into the private sector. And people are really starting to question, why do we use background checks for employment? If we want to defund the police, if we don't believe the police are doing an ethical job all the time, why would we use a police record to discriminate against somebody? And so there's a new consciousness emerging. Now, I'm sure you're aware of, we have a presidential election coming up. So there's also this new rhetoric that crime is returning to the cities, and our President Trump is certainly using law and order as a political platform. So it's, you know, it's a very complicated time, but I appreciate the questions. And I do think that people are starting to recognize that privacy can be part of criminal justice, and these awful circumstances are helping to bring that conversation to the forefront.
Obrigado, professora. A gente tem algumas perguntas aqui, e eu tenho consciência que temos até as 7 da noite aqui no Brasil, então temos mais 3 minutos. Vamos tentar fazer mais 2 blocos de perguntas. Tem um grupo de perguntas aqui, uma feita pela professora Heloísa Estelita, da FGV, também do José Mário Araújo, e ainda do Felipe Roquete, algumas pessoas na nossa ferramenta de perguntas e respostas, a respeito de iniciativas regulatórias nos Estados Unidos, né? Então, a professora Heloísa Estelita, por exemplo, pergunta se há algum projeto de lei ou iniciativa legislativa para proteção de dados nos processos judiciais nos Estados Unidos, né? Imagino que haja uma diferença também de estado para estado, etc. Né? Então, vou juntar essas perguntas e fazer o seguinte questionamento. Que tipo de agenda regulatória que tem avançado e quais são os desafios para que ela avance no contexto estadunidense a respeito desses temas, né, de justiça criminal e de tratamento de dados na justiça criminal?
Yeah, excellent questions. Unfortunately, it is a very segmented system. So we think of the 50 states having 50 different legal systems. But if you really get into it, it's like 3,000 different legal systems, because so much of criminal justice happens at the county, the local level. So there has not been sweeping reform. There are not bills on the table for this, mostly because of this problem of pre-conviction records being considered a public record. So the arrest records and court records aren't considered criminal records. They're considered court records or police records that happen to talk about people. And so to sort of take away that transparency is obviously not a popular proposition. I do think there's easy ways to do it. I think that we could, if we call things a criminal record and we talk about the record being the collection of lots of different police and court sources into one file, that actually is very easy to have privacy protections for within existing US law. So we'd have to reclassify the records. States could start doing that. There has been some litigation, so that it's America, right? So the lawsuits are gonna be the way that policy reform happens. But really, I think that there has been, the most attention's been in the federal courts, the state level, or the district courts. And so that's the trial, the lawsuit level. And so, you know, there was a big case in Pennsylvania where they used privacy as an argument and about mugshots, and the judge awarded millions of dollars in a class action lawsuit saying that those are now considered criminal records, even though the state said they were public records. So my answer is, I think tinkering with existing law does give us a lot of options, and we need judicial review on how that law is going to be interpreted. And when it comes to sort of internet privacy in general, again, it's just not probably on the horizon anytime soon. I did see a nice question about sort of the commodification of educational and medical records being similar. It's such a good point. I completely agree with that. You know, the danger would be, you know, to take the criminal record and turn it into an even bigger business than it is. So my policy suggestion to states is to centralize your data collection, manage it, decide what employers get to see, decide what landlords get to see. It's a very European model to criminal records. And I think it would save the states a lot of time and effort. And frankly, I think the states could pay for it themselves by just charging people an access fee. And I will add that this gets extra complicated because the media have a complicated relationship with this proposition, because it does infringe on their sort of rights to access government data. So a journalist wants to have access to the court record, and I understand why. But for, you know, advocates that are pushing for privacy, it can be hard to get media attention when you have sort of different value systems going in opposition to each other.
Obrigado. Bom, aí, encaminhando para os comentários finais, eu vou aproveitar, na verdade, a pergunta feita pelo Felipe Roquete ainda, que falou sobre viés em algoritmos, né? E pedir um comentário da professora a respeito, um pouco mais aprofundado, a respeito do uso desses algoritmos, né, ou de sistemas automatizados para organização, né, da persecução penal, e não só, né, a própria forma de coleta dos dados, não só o viés, né, no sistema automatizado que trata os dados, mas o viés na coleta, como sendo um desafio, né? Então, entender quais são, como tratar esse possível viés na coleta de um certo banco de dados. E, na sequência, aproveitando também a pergunta do usuário anônimo a respeito da legislação sobre transparência, queria também que a professora traçasse algum paralelo nos seus comentários finais agora sobre como lidar com essa discussão de transparência no atual contexto político. Bom, de toda forma, justiça criminal nunca foi um assunto muito fácil de lidar politicamente, né? A professora citou as eleições, etc. Mas, para além disso, a gente tem uma discussão aqui no Brasil, por exemplo, a respeito da necessidade de avanço de uma legislação de proteção de dados e da necessidade de conservação de direitos de transparência, de direitos de acesso à informação. Então, pensando nesse, em termos de debate político, né, como conciliar uma coisa e a outra? É claro que é uma pergunta, às vezes, que se repete, mas que, nesse contexto de pandemia, inclusive, que o Brasil foi um dos campeões no mau sentido, em termos de transparência pública, etc., acho que vale a pena considerar essas considerações. Então, passo a palavra para a professora para as suas considerações finais a respeito de todos esses assuntos que eu falei e acabei confundindo mais do que esclarecendo.
No, that's excellent. So about the algorithms. So essentially, we have cash bail in America. So if you are arrested and you're held in jail, the judge, upon recommendation from the prosecutor, will say $10,000, you can go home, don't have the money, you stay in jail. And there's a problem, obviously a problem with that. So poor people stay in jail and rich people get to leave even if they've committed a terrible crime. And states that have gotten rid of cash bail, New Jersey being one of the first, have adopted risk assessment tools. So they look at their own data, they look at court data to see whether or not a person has previous arrests, previous convictions, and if they've ever failed to appear in a court date. So that's sort of the basic kind of risk assessment tool that's used instead of bail. That is a sort of promising, right? That's sort of an equalizing algorithm. The one issue being, if you're a young Black man in Newark, where I work, you often have been arrested 15, 20 times by the way that police have been deployed and been asked to do broken window style policing, right? Which is to get people off corners, to search people. And so the problem for that young man is that he may have never been engaging in criminal activity, but he still has a lot of arrests. So now he may have to stay in jail because of the algorithmic output. But the nice thing is the judges do have some discretion. The defense attorney can speak to it. So that's sort of like a more open algorithm. There are examples, though, where a much more complicated algorithms from private companies are being used. There's been wonderful data journalism on this. And these algorithms are used to decide whether or not someone is a risk to be let go from jail when setting their sentence, all sorts of different criminal justice outcomes. And there's a great book by Kathy O'Neill called The Weapons of Mass Destruction. And she really breaks down this idea of the self-reinforcing loop of using system data about a person. So using criminal legal data about a person to make more criminal legal decisions. And then of course you start to add in other factors, maybe social psychological factors, which are really just correlates to poverty. So it's really a criminalization of the poor when you start to bring in risk factors associated to renting a home rather than owning a home, or the type of neighborhood or the educational level that you've obtained. So there's a lot of wonderful scholarship and thought on this. And I'm on Twitter, I'm always happy to chat on Twitter. So just hit me up directly if you wanna talk more about that. The transparency problem is a great question. And I think that the trick is to sort of pick your strategy carefully. So I do think it's possible to demand institutional transparency while not being misled by the types of data that they're giving you. So in my case, we're getting information about the defendants and the accused, but we don't know anything about police misconduct. We don't know anything about the decision-making process of prosecutors. We have no data in the US that shows why or why not a prosecutor pursued charges or just let the person go, right? So there's all sorts of accountability that you might not think of right away, where the system is not sharing their data, but they have it, and then they'll give you other data. And so I think that, you know, a way in the middle for me has been to think about how do we get subject level data for the person, right? So a lot of people in my study had never seen their record themselves. They never saw their official criminal record. Now, the public could look up various parts of it and see it, but the person couldn't. And so you can imagine a scenario where you'd pass some sort of policy where the subject themselves can have access to their own data. They can try to clean it, remedy it, find the source of the errors, and have some ownership over it. And so if there's a way that people can find out when their license plate has shown up in databases, right? And that, so they can self-monitor and sort of be thoughtful about getting some control over their own data. What kind of programs can we develop so that people can sit down with a volunteer expert who can walk them through all these different data sets or these background check companies that they might be contained in? So I think just literacy and transparency about each person's own data and developing policies and programs that could help with that could go a really long way. And I did want to say, I saw one last comment in the Q&A I want to just respond to is about that we are funding our own surveillance. I think that's super crucial to throw in there. It's a great comment that a lot of the times we are unwittingly engaging in this peer-to-peer surveillance that we often critique the state for doing. So I think, you know, having a thoughtful reflection about the data you consume and the data that you inadvertently collect and share and sort of your own role in this ecosystem, I think for me at least helped me organize kind of my own values around the critiques that I make about how the state is doing this. And I'm so sorry I have to leave. I have to teach my first class tonight. So that's the only reason I have to go. But I really am grateful for this. And I would love to hear from the people who joined today on Twitter, or you can email me and we can continue these conversations. I think they're very important. And I'm also very grateful for the opportunity to learn about the Brazilian context. I spent all week reading about Brazil, and we have much to discuss. So thank you so much.
Muito obrigado, professora. Então, nos despedimos. Muito obrigado. Fico o convite de você acompanhar os demais painéis do Congresso e também, enfim, continuamos o contato. Obrigado, viu? Até mais. Continuamos aqui, pessoal, para conversar um pouco sobre o nosso congresso. Estamos na abertura. Sem muitas delongas, vou passar a palavra para a professora Marta Saad, para que ela faça, vamos dizer, uma saudação de abertura do congresso, comente um pouco o que a gente estava pensando para esse ano. Em seguida, também vou falar um pouco disso. E peço que a gente fique até também o final, porque eu tenho alguns avisos do ponto de vista mais administrativo, operacional, que eu queria fazer para todos e para todas. Mas passo a palavra para a professora Marta. Tudo bom, professora?
Obrigada, Francisco.
Depois dessa palestra.
Pois é. É incrível. Eu acho que a professora Sarah trouxe vários insights para a gente pensar. Acho que isso vai orientar todos esses dias de congresso. Eu fico muito feliz, né? Desde 2017, a Faculdade de Direito da USP cedia, esse ano virtualmente, né, o Congresso Internacional do Internet Lab sobre Direitos Fundamentais e Processo Penal na Era Digital. Eu acho que é evidente para quem teve chance de acompanhar desde o início que os temas vão sendo lapidados. Eu me lembro do primeiro congresso ainda com o Denis Francisco. A ideia ali original era tratar de devido processo penal, tutela ainda de privacidade, sigilo das comunicações. Isso foi afunilando no ano seguinte, em 2018, a gente já começou a falar das novas capacidades, das estratégias de investigação. No ano passado, né, a gente tratou mais de coleta e emprego de dados biométricos, de dados genéticos, políticas de segurança pública, e esse ano, enfim, mesmo que distantes, né, fazendo pela primeira vez em ambiente online, a quarta edição do Congresso, eu fico feliz por isso, porque acho que as pessoas já esperam, coloco esse evento assim no calendário realmente anual de quem acompanha os debates dessa relação tão próxima do processo penal com a tecnologia. E neste ano em particular, assim que nós estamos mais distantes, infelizmente não podemos estar no ambiente físico da faculdade, por outro lado também nós estamos mais conectados, sentindo as facilidades, o poder, né, da tecnologia, mas também as nossas exposições, nossas fragilidades nesse tipo de ambiente. Então, nesse ano em particular, o Congresso tem como fio condutor a proteção dos dados pessoais no âmbito da segurança pública e investigações criminais. Isso é particularmente importante porque está em discussão, né, a elaboração de um anteprojeto exatamente para a absorção dessas novas tecnologias na prevenção, na repreensão e depois no próprio processamento no sistema de justiça criminal, na apuração de infrações penais. Então, de hoje, né, começando de forma brilhante com dessa exposição da Sarah, e eu acho que todo mundo ficou curioso para ver o livro, que é bastante interessante pelo que a gente já viu aqui, da fala dela e a pesquisa dela, que é conhecida. Até o dia 4, então, nós vamos ter essa semana e a próxima semana, vários painéis tratando das questões de policiamento, proteção de dados, vigilância em massa, questões preditivas, né? Como o fluxo de informações pode ser utilizado, proteção de sigilo de comunicações. A gente vai ter de novo o professor Tércio participando de um evento do Internet Lab, ele que é autor de um texto clássico, e todas as vezes acho que ele é provocado a revisitar esse assunto, né, de privacidade, intimidade, comunicação, sigilo das comunicações. Depois é um painel sobre métodos ocultos de investigação, cooperação jurídica internacional, de novo a questão dos bancos de dados, tudo isso debatido, né, com especialistas em privacidade e proteção de dados, também com os operadores do direito, acho que de todas as carreiras, né, tem juiz, procurador da República, promotor, advogado, delegado de polícia, professores, né, de direito penal e processo penal, também da faculdade. E acho que fechando no último dia, à tarde, um debate com os integrantes, uma mesa, né, virtual, entre os integrantes da comissão de juristas, alguns deles, né, incumbidos da elaboração do anteprojeto de lei sobre tratamento de dados pessoais para fins de segurança pública e atividades de investigação. Então, para quem acompanha esse tema de processo penal e a sua relação com a tecnologia, eu acho que esse é um congresso importante. Fico muito feliz, Nathalie, Chico, que a gente tenha conseguido, né, vocês principalmente, organizar isso. Eu sou uma consultora, nem sei como eu me intitulo aqui, mas uma palpiteira de assuntos e de pessoas que possam falar sobre processo penal e penal relacionados a esses temas. Então, desejo que a gente tenha vários dias aqui de muito debate, muita discussão, e agradeço novamente pela chance da faculdade poder estar junto do Internet Lab nessa agenda.
Obrigado, professora. Professora Marta, uma apoiadora de primeira hora desse evento, que, como ela disse, está virando uma espécie de tradição e que muito nos orgulha no Internet Lab, né? A ideia de fazer um congresso como esse, e é importante a gente sempre reiterar, né, nessa abertura dos nossos congressos, é que a gente consiga, a partir de múltiplas visões, a partir de um olhar acadêmico, jurídico, mas bastante voltado para a prática jurídica também, a gente aprofunde esses debates sobre sistemas de fronteira. Todo ano a gente escolhe um tema, mas é um tema guarda-chuva, né, que busca contemplar uma série de discussões da ordem do dia, mas a partir de algum norte, vamos dizer, né? E como bem disse a professora Marta, a gente está entrando no quarto ano, e tem algumas novidades e algumas questões que a gente queria contar para todo mundo aqui, porque dizem respeito às edições passadas, uma certa, vamos dizer, uma surpresa, né, para os participantes que a gente preparou, e também diz respeito a essa edição, também alguns detalhes operacionais. Mas antes de passar tudo isso, eu queria só agradecer mais uma vez a faculdade, agradecer a professora Marta, Departamento de Direito Processual da Faculdade de Direito da USP, e dizer que é um enorme prazer para a nossa Internet Lab poder estar junto nessa empreitada. Aí é o seguinte, gente, todo congresso, a gente registra, né, do ponto de vista de vídeo e tal, não vai ser diferente com esse congresso, a gente também está gravando todas as mesas, vamos dizer, mesas virtuais, a partir dessa ferramenta do Zoom, etc. Vamos gravar, vamos disponibilizar em formato editado gratuitamente, né, nos nossos canais das redes sociais, né, no nosso site do Internet Lab ou no mesmo no canal do YouTube do Internet Lab. Mas, além disso, há um esforço que a gente tem todo ano de pegar as discussões que aconteceram no congresso anterior e organizar um livro que é chamado Direitos Fundamentais e Processo Penal na Era Digital, Doutrina e Prática em Debate. E a ideia desse livro é contemplar essas discussões, então a gente busca engajar justamente com os expositores, os palestrantes do congresso que veio no ano anterior. Então, como vocês podem ver na tela, o primeiro livro é o livro Azulzinho, é do congresso de 2017, foi o livro lançado em 2018. Né? E o tema principal aí que envolveu os debates, principalmente era a questão da criptografia de ponta a ponta, né? E o acesso a conteúdo das comunicações. O segundo congresso produziu o segundo livro, que foi lançado na terceira edição. Esse segundo livro é em especial dedicado para olhar para a atividade policial, né? Que é o livro Verdinho, né? Investigações policiais, tem a discussão a respeito de flagrantes, etc. E o terceiro livro, que será lançado neste ano, é o livrinho Laranja, que vocês podem observar aí, que é o livrinho que compila as discussões do ano passado, que está sendo lançado hoje, nesse momento, e é o nosso livro a respeito de, principalmente, discussões de biometria, de DNA, então uma série de dados biométricos, né, utilizados nas investigações, utilizados no processo penal. Então tem discussão sobre banco de perfis genéticos, tem discussão a respeito de reconhecimento facial e do uso desses dados nas atividades de investigação, nas atividades persecutórias. Então, com muito prazer que a gente lança esse livro desse ano, e mais do que isso, né? Todo ano esses livros são lançados em PDF gratuito para qualquer pessoa que quiser baixar eles direto no site do Internet Lab. Mas esse ano a gente preparou uma surpresinha. Todos os três livros, até o final da semana, eles também estarão disponíveis, aliás, já estão disponíveis em EPUB e em formato de e-book. Né? Isso pode ser também baixado no site do Internet Lab, isso também estará disponível até o final da semana, aí sim, na loja da Amazon a custo zero, né? Gratuitamente. Então, os três livros até o final da semana estarão disponíveis permanentemente para quem quiser baixar, para quem quiser acessar esse conteúdo. E essa vira uma tradição, continua, né? A tradição do Congresso de sempre compilar. Ano que vem a gente vai ter o livro Direitos Fundamentais e Processo Penal na Era Digital, Doutrina e Prática em Debate, volume 4, a respeito das discussões que a gente está fazendo neste ano, nesse congresso desse ano. Então, é um convite aí para entrar no site do Internet Lab, acessar o conteúdo do livro do ano passado ou dos livros dos anos anteriores, caso vocês não tenham. Acho que é um esforço que a gente faz que geralmente fica muito interessante porque é uma compilação, uma organização. Às vezes a gente traz até mais coisa do que teve no ano anterior, buscando aí não só a transcrição do que os palestrantes falaram, mas se os palestrantes quiseram organizar e adicionar mais coisas e mais referências em suas falas e publicar em um artigo. Então, é um verdadeiro livro de artigos acadêmicos a respeito dessas questões. Bom, tem essa questão do livro, acho que é isso, fico com o convite para todo mundo baixar. Eu gostaria de pedir desculpa a todos os participantes pela necessidade de juntar as perguntas que a gente teve nessa palestra. Foi um exercício meu como moderador para tentar aproveitar o tempo da professora Sara. Então, peço desculpa aos participantes que fizeram pergunta ali e eventualmente não foram contemplados. E é isso, né? A gente tem esse formato digital, tem os seus ônus e os seus bônus, né? O formato digital também tem suas limitações, que não dá para a gente estar junto, passando o microfone, né? A gente precisa de ter uma organização. Vamos tentar focar nessa ferramenta de perguntas e respostas que parece funcionar bem aqui no Zoom. Além disso, tem alguns recados operacionais. Então, a primeira coisa é que a participação no Congresso é restrita aos inscritos, né? Mas as palestras são gravadas, né? E elas serão disponibilizadas, como eu disse, tanto no site do Congresso, congresso.internetlab.org.br, tanto lá como no canal do Internet Lab no YouTube, assim que o Congresso terminar e a gente editar esse material. Então, algum tempinho, algumas semanas aí para a gente fazer isso. Em segundo lugar, sugiro que quem está chegando agora fique atento em conferir a programação e atento aos e-mails que a gente envia um pouquinho antes das sessões começarem. A gente enviou um e-mail a todos os inscritos e inscritas com todos os links de todas as mesas. Então, peço que vocês deem uma olhada, quem não recebeu, se não caiu na caixa de spam, eventualmente. Mas, mesmo assim, antes de cada uma das mesas, a gente vai enviar um lembrete com o link da mesa daquela hora, daquele momento, para que a pessoa tenha a mão diretamente, né? Além disso, a questão dos certificados de participação. Os certificados de participação, eles serão emitidos àqueles que solicitaram, no ato da inscrição, o certificado, né? Tinha lá uma caixinha para falar que você queria o certificado e que compareceram ao Congresso, né? A gente tem o controle disso a partir do login aqui na ferramenta do Zoom, né? Então, todo mundo que logou aqui, acompanhou as mesas, vai ter o certificado enviado assim que o Congresso terminar e a gente aferir aí essa presença nos painéis do Congresso. Além disso, da perspectiva operacional, teve uma pergunta aqui no chat sobre o volume 3, né, do ano passado. Está disponível em PDF? Também estará disponível em PDF. Estará disponível em todos os formatos, no nosso site, no site do Congresso também, no site do Internet Lab. Vai ter a possibilidade de fácil acesso a partir do nosso site e do site do Congresso também. Tá bom? Nathalie, que é a nossa coordenadora da área de privacidade e vigilância e que organizou o congresso da perspectiva aí da montagem de todas as mesas, queria perguntar se eu esqueci alguma coisa de aviso para os nossos participantes. Esqueci ou está tudo certo, Nathalie? Não esqueci, tudo certo, muito bem. Bom, além disso, eu queria também agradecer muito sinceramente aos nossos intérpretes que estão aqui conosco e que estarão conosco em todas as mesas que a gente tem convidados internacionais. Então, obrigado, Beatriz, obrigado, Robert. Enfim, é um prazer contar com vocês. Além disso, queria agradecer muitíssimo aos queridos colaboradores, né, e pesquisadores do Internet Lab, a equipe do Internet Lab, que fez um trabalho muito bacana de colocar tudo isso de pé. Então, queria agradecer ao Sérgio Mota, nosso coordenador de comunicação, a Alessandra Gomes, a nossa Tech Fellow, ao Henrico Roberto, pesquisadora, a Clarice Tavares, também pesquisadora, ao Vitor Pavarin, nosso estagiário, enfim, a toda a equipe, a Marina Valente também, minha colega diretora do Internet Lab, que também nos ajuda e, enfim, vai mediar uma série de mesas aí durante os próximos dias. A gente sempre vai ter uma pessoa do Internet Lab mediando a mesa. A Mariana vai mediar, a Nathalie vai mediar, o Henrico vai mediar também, ainda a professora Marta. Enfim, Mais ou menos isso. Eu acho que tem mais uma pergunta aqui a respeito dos livros da Amazon. Se eles ainda não estão a preço zero, é porque a gente ainda não teve tempo de mudar. É só aguardar um ou dois dias que eles estarão a custo zero na Amazon também. Mas eles também podem ser baixados gratuitamente no nosso site, no site do Congresso. Bom, agradecimentos feitos. Peço desculpas pela... me alongar aqui, mas é isso, o Congresso está iniciado. Muito obrigado a todos e todas e até amanhã. A gente vai ter, só repassando a programação de amanhã, nós temos na parte da manhã a nossa segunda keynote speaker, que é a Sophie Clavet, que falará sobre proteção de dados e tecnologias de vigilância, enfrentando as questões do policiamento. Isso fica a ver que é uma consultora na área, teve uma passagem pela Interpol e também fará uma das convidadas internacionais na parte da manhã, às 10 da manhã. E na parte da noite, às 19 horas, a gente vai ter o nosso primeiro painel, que chama-se Do Domicílio aos Dados, o debate constitucional sobre privacidade, intimidade e proteção de dados no Brasil, que contará com a presença do professor Gustavo Badaró, da Faculdade de Direito da USP, e da professora Luísa Machado, professora da FGV Direito São Paulo. Muito obrigado a todos e todas, então, até amanhã, e foi dado início aí aos nossos trabalhos. Professora Marta.
Muito bom. Começou.
Tchau, pessoal.